PHYS University, where you must try the roasted owl. It's General Physics 1. Today, Impulse, featuring Momentum. Dr. Stenson. Also, a literary reading. And now, a man who's known online as Dr. McStreamy. Professor Hafner.
Quite as popular after an exam, so that tends to happen. So welcome to General Physics 1. Let's see, what do we need to talk about? What could we possibly have to talk? Oh yeah, we just had the exam. So the exam was Friday, at least electronically in terms of Canvas. I think it went well. Now you see how it works. Everything's set to A, so you don't know the answers when you turn it in. And I set the real answers and it auto grades the whole thing. So that's what happened. So let's look at the grade distribution. So hot off the presses here, there it is. So the average was 73, which is very standard. I think every exam I've given in 4 years of teaching this class has been between 70 and 80. Creeped over 80 maybe once or twice. Very typical. What's a little untypical is the width of the distribution. Usually a little tighter, a little broader, which is understandable. It's a new kind of exam, new kind of semester, so people do differently. One thing I always want to know is what letter grade goes on the exam. And we technically don't give letter grades until the end, right? We just do numbers and then whatever. Well, not whatever, it's important, but that's what we usually do. But you do have those cutoffs. Right, so you could look at the cutoff and you could look at your grade and see where you would be. But even the cutoffs tend to come down. So here I'm going to give you a little insight if you really want to know where you are based on this exam, especially since the distribution is so broad. So when we look at final grades and assign the final grade, there's no magic formula, but one place where you start is just say, let's just look at where the top quarter is, the middle 50% is, and the bottom quarter is, and say A's, B's, C's. And we never leave it that way. That's not the magic formula, okay? Then we think a lot about how they do and how this do compared to last year and where are there giant gaps in the grades and how many of these are we giving out? So then like hours of thought goes in. But that initial, that's just where you usually start. So here's what that looks like here. So down to, I think it was 84 would be the top quarter. So some sort of A minus A, I don't know. I'm not telling you where that is, that we distribute them roughly evenly, so figure it out. B's in this case would go all the way down to 64. So that's pretty low, it's still gonna be. So if you got like a high 60, you're okay. You've got some sort of a low B probably. The reason that's going so low is because the distribution was so broad. If you use this 25%, 50%, 20%, that's why that's being driven down. If you look at the cuts in the syllabus, it was 87 for A, so that only drops to 84, and it was supposed to be 77 for B, and now I'm saying 64. Oh my God, is that, do you promise that's the cut on the final grades? No, I'm just trying to give you some idea of how we work here. The bottom quarter, C's, and potentially D's, and even the worst case scenario, F's. Okay, but we do our best to avoid anyone failing this class. No matter where you are in that distribution, you have not failed this class. Okay, so we really work at the bottom and you'll do better. And one grade is just 20%. So really, you know, if you had a really low score, you might have fated yourself to a B or a C and not an A. But no one is fated to fail at this point. On the exam, we did the thing where you can send questions and we'll answer them and we'll look at them and say, were any of them so problematic we need to throw them out? And the answer this time was basically no. We got like maybe 15 emails spread over probably 10 different problems. So there was the only systematic thing was number 23. And that was really just not, just know how to do it. So that was all it was. So it was the one, I want to describe it real quick. And I think I know why people struggled with this one. So two planets orbit the same star. Hopefully you're just immediately drawing things when you see this, right? Planet one has radius R, So it's kind of close. Planet 2 is four times that rate. It's 2. So way out here. Something like that. And they're orbiting the star like this. So they're actually going in a circle, unlike what I drew. And the question was, by what factor do their periods relate? So most people were asking, you didn't give us VT. How are we supposed to get it without VT? So the answer is it's a gravity problem, because you've got to figure out what VT is. And by VT, I mean, you know, how fast are these things going? You know, VT. Because you knew immediately that, oh, I need that speed to get the period, because I have the radius. I have radius 1 and I have radius 2. So I need that speed to get the period. And once I know the period, or once I know the speed, I know the circumference, and I get the period. So you feel like you should be given that V. But the point is, it's a gravity question. It's not a circular motion question. It's a gravity question. So that's why you would say, let's look at planet 1. And let's look at planet 2. And do the whole sum of the forces of the centripetal direction is the mass of the acceleration in the centripetal direction. And say, what's the only force on planet 1? Big G, mass of the star, mass of planet 1, over the radius of planet 1 squared equals the mass of planet 1. And the centripetal acceleration of planet 1 is that V you're looking for, that you want. So you look at this, you'll see a couple things. One is the mass goes away, and then that radius turns into the right radius. We did this in class. And you could write it this way. You could say that V that I need is the square root of big G, mass of the sun, over radius 1. And when I went back to the videotape and watched, and I didn't make a big, strong physical point that anything orbiting a star has a certain speed based on its radius, and the mass doesn't matter. See, the mass of the planet went away. So you have this one is going at that, and V2 is the square root of G, mass of the star, radius of 2. So this was the idea of how you're supposed to get there. Asking for the ratio of the periods is basically the same as asking for the ratio of the speeds, because you have the two R's, and then this expression is all stuff we gave you, right? Constant, and then you have this ratio. So if you write out that ratio, blah, 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 and you get down to 8. So I think what went wrong is it looked like a circular motion problem. So there on your exam strategy, you realize this is the gravity part. I should probably do some gravity. And the other thing that went wrong is we didn't do a lot of these symbolic ratio kind of questions. So we'll try to do more of those before the next exam. We tend to do more numerical. So sorry about that. That's the only one I really wanted to address. I think everything else, when you see the solutions, which we'll post soon, you'll see what to do. Let's see. I think that was really it. Attendance was up Thursday, 81%. We hit 81%. Well, there you go. And today, so what we're doing today, the erase my talk, is we're going to talk about impulse and momentum. And maybe a little bit on conservation if we get there. But this week is all about momentum. Doing momentum in 1 week by not covering it quite in level of detail as usual, and a little bit of it is going to be pushed into the energy thing. So we're doing impulse and momentum. We're doing momentum this week, then we're doing energy for 2 weeks, and then we're doing something for a week. I forgot what it is. And then we'll do another review and then exam 2. So we're on the exact same schedule. All right. I'm sure there are more questions about the exam. I'll leave it to Dr. Stinson's judgment if any of them are something I should address here. Let's see. I'm gonna take that as a no. Okay, I don't have the chat up here, but we're not really doing reviews, so it's okay. Okay, here we go. Here we go. Here's a real quick big picture thing. There are three ways to, he fell on me. This is for later. To do mechanics. This needs to go somewhere else, but anywhere I put it, it's going to fall. Okay, well, this is just a problem. Okay, so three ways to do mechanics, and then what they're good for. You have been learning forces, and those are good for getting the detail
kinematics. Figuring out what's the velocity, position, acceleration of everything. But there's some kind of problems that are very hard to do with forces. All right, so let's look at another thing you can use, and that is this week. Momentum. It's good for collisions and interactions between two objects. And you will see why.
And then, next week, even a third way.
If you don't like one of these, you're going to like the other ones.
A third way is energy. And for energy, it's good for initial,
final state problems.
So any sort of mechanics problem, you can solve with any of the three of these. It's just some of them mathematically become really difficult in some methods, and some are easier. So, and sometimes you have to combine them to solve a problem, as we'll see. But these are just three different approaches. Energy, of course, is for a lot more than mechanics problem. It's a very important concept in the universe. But in what we're learning here, it's good for a certain kind of mechanics problem. All right, so we'll start with momentum. That needs to stay there. Hey, that works. I'll just hang it behind the wall. Okay, momentum. Here we go. Momentum. It's just mass times velocity. That's true. All it is. So it's not a big, long equation to give you the momentum. We describe it with a small p, so that must be equal to m, v. One of those has to be a vector, and of course it's v. The velocity is a vector, mass is a scalar. You can multiply with scalar times a vector. All right, so properties of momentum that are interesting. It's a vector. That will come back to haunt you in certain kinds of problems. You always have to remember it's a vector. Its unit is kilogram meters per second. As you can see, kilogram meters per second. Has no fancy name like a Newton or a Torr or anything. If you discover something very fundamental in momentum studies, perhaps it'll be named after you. And this is actually, so it's interesting. If you go back and read Newton's original laws in the original Latin, which of course I can do, what you find is he doesn't say force equals mass times acceleration. He basically is sort of vague about, he's vague about the mathematical quantities involved, right? It's just words. And he refers to the quantity of motion. So, the state, well, both. This is Newton's state of motion. He talks about the state of motion being changed. So my point is that momentum is really sort of the most fundamental of all these things. Like forces and masses and velocities, those are all good and they work. But momentum is really the fundamental thing that Newton was talking about that is conserved. So maybe they should call it like an Isaac. You know, they made force Newtons, so they should also name momentum after him. So normal times I do a demo, I jump on a skateboard and I go by and I calculate my momentum. All right, so here is that demo. I don't usually fall like that. Okay, so here I am. I'm going 3 meters per second on the skateboard. Go real fast on skateboards. And my mass is, let's say, 80 kilograms, something like that. And we say, what's momentum? Well, you multiply, right? You can do this. So P, now let's just call it P at first. Let's just do the magnitude. All right, 80, you do it all in MKS units, times 3, 240 kilogram meters per second. But we're not done, we gotta get the direction.
So remember, it is a vector. So if this is y, and this is x, if I wanted to write it, formal vector notation, it would be 240 kilogram meters per second, I hat. or if that just gives you highs. People also write like x hat.
We mean the x-axis, if you wanted to put a unit vector on it. We don't require you to use unit vector notation. You saw on the exam, I don't think there was a single unit vector on the exam, but we do require you to remember that it's a vector. And there will be times when it's critical that it's a vector. Okay, whether you want to go with that notation, that's up to you. All right, next. Oh, now I have to erase. Okay, so we've defined momentum. So let me erase real fast. I cleaned my erasers. It's gonna go faster than usual. Going slower than usual because I also cleaned the pores. It's hard to erase them clearly when there's clean pores. Okay. So momentum, you got that concept down. Mass times velocity. Everything you know about velocity, multiply times mass, and you've got momentum.
Here's another quantity: impulse.
Okay, here we go. A change in momentum. All right, we use a big J to describe it, but it's also in kilogram meters per second, and it's also a vector. So you could ask, why,
if it's just delta P, why don't we write delta V?
Now, we don't have a special name for delta V. Why do we have a special name for delta P? No, we just do. Okay. It is more of a fundamental thing about mechanics and how the universe works. But in terms of what you're learning about physics, is there anything special about this beyond it being delta P? No. All right. It's just delta P. It's the change of momentum. We gave it a fancy name, impulse. All right. So let me give you maybe a little insight why, and a little bit about sort of Newton's laws. So let's start with velocity acceleration relationship. What's the relation between those? For constant A, what is it? It's the delta V equals A delta T. That's like the definition of the acceleration when it's constant. It's delta V over delta T. If something is changing, it's dV dt. What we can do is take step two and multiply by mass on both sides, okay? Then what are we gonna get? Then we're gonna get M times delta V. And what are we gonna get over here? M times A delta T. Okay, and then we look at that and we say, well, this thing is delta P, so that's just J, all right? Delta P, but that becomes J. So we see this impulse is equal to, well, it's equal to delta P by definition. What is this? This is force, F equals ma, so the force is, or you could say the net force on something is ma, and just times delta T. So this change in momentum in terms of forces is that it's F times delta T. Okay, this is kind of the link between the momentum ideas and the force kinematics ideas, is that the impulse, you can pick up an impulse. You can have a change in momentum if a force is applied for some time, a net force. Right now we're just doing one forces at a time. So this was nice when you had constant acceleration. So this is easy to use. I have a force for a certain time. I get a certain change in momentum that we call impulse. But what if my force is changing? If my force is changing, then my acceleration is changing. If my acceleration is changing, then this isn't true. And if this isn't true, then this isn't true. Or this is like too specific, right? This is the constant acceleration version. So we could say, for changing force or changing acceleration, however you want to say it,
We know that delta of V is the integral of A dt. Okay, this is what I'm showing you, the calculus part, from t initial to t final. Okay, so you're okay with this. Let's just write the calculus version and then talk about the difference. You don't have to do this derivation, okay? So again, multiply through by mass. What do you get? You get that m times delta v, which is what? Delta p. And the mass, a constant, can just go in the integral. Integral from t initial to t final, ma dt. Okay,
so we're basically doing the exact same thing, just with the calculus version for when things are changing, not when things are constant. So what we find is that this impulse, it still equals delta p. Over some time, right, there's a p initial, p final. Subtract those, that's the impulse. But we can also write it as an integral for cases when the force changes. Force f dt from ti to tf. Okay. So most problems you do this, right? But if we were going to do high-level calculus problems or something, we would do a bunch of that. We might do a teeny bit of that. Okay, I forgot. I've got to look at the homework to see if we ever, I think maybe there's one on there. Okay, but it's just a time-varying force, right? F will be a function of time. Maybe it's just a constant times time. So the integral is 1/2 the constant times time squared. All right, so no tricky integrals, that's all. But anyway, these are the two definitions of impulse, and they're actually the same. It's just one is for constant forces, constant accelerations. One is for variable forces, variable accelerations. Okay, so now what we're going to do is do an example problem about a young snowboarder named Cent. And you are going to hear the story of Cent during the break. I'm doing the problem first. Good Lord, that's the way things worked out. I gotta remember that he's back there. Maybe Yoda got very violent over the season break. This didn't happen before. Okay. So we're gonna just think about this physically and do just a quick calculation for impulse. Let me see what time it is. Okay, so here's what happens. You'll hear about it during the break. It's pretty incredible. So you have an avalanche, right? Big snowy avalanche, and it's coming at Cent, right? And she's on her, what's that called? The snowboard? What's the thing that they, snowboard, yeah. She's on a snowboard. And she's just sitting there minding her business, okay? And then the avalanche hits her. And it makes her, like, here she's at rest, right? V equals zero. And then, and the avalanche hits her and it speeds her up. And she ends up, at the end, going at V, F, like that. So, minding her business, avalanche hits her. And when the avalanche is done, she's going at V, F, okay? So, the simple question is, oh, and then I'll draw this. Have to watch the literary reading of the break to know what that means. Okay, so avalanche pushes her with constant force. So avalanche pushes Cent with constant force F for delta T, for time delta T, to accelerate from V equals zero to VF. Okay. So what we could do is we could make a plot of that versus time. Okay, so we could say, here we go. Here is the force on Cent. Okay, she, and this is time. Remember, so these impulses are applying a force for a certain amount of time, so you would always plot force versus time. So minding your own business, avalanche hits, pushes her at constant force, which makes the problem easier. And then the avalanche stops. Okay, so that's a plot of force versus time.
So then we say, okay, well then, what is the impulse? What is the change in momentum for this problem? So you just look at it and you say, well, I can just use my formula. J equals delta P, those are the same thing, impulse. And it's really just this force that was applied, force ABA for avalanche, A-V-A, times the delta T. That's the formula for constant force, right? F delta T. So you look at that and realize F avalanche is the height of this, and there's delta T, right? That's the width, so it's just the area. Right. So these things are the area under F T plot. So if you visualize it that way, area under the plot, which makes a lot of sense because it was the integral of f times dt. And we know that the integral is the area under the curve, right? So if this is constant, then it's just a rectangle. That's why you don't need an integral to do it. It's just the height times the width. But if this is changing, then that's when you need an integral. That's the difference. That's the only reason there's two. So let's do a quick numerical. Let's just run some numbers on sent. Let's say it pushed her at 300 newtons. And her mass is 60 kilograms, and this was 5 seconds. And sent is 60 kg. Then if you want the impulse, you just say, oh, it's just the product of all those, basically. The mass, I'm sorry, it's you say it's the force times delta T. It was 300 newtons. Times delta T, 5 seconds. So it's 1,500 newton seconds. And you say, wait, I thought it was supposed to be in kilogram meters per second. If you take a newton times a second, you get kilogram meters per second. Right? Because kilogram meters per second squared times seconds. Right. So so sometimes you call it newton seconds, or you can call it kilogram meters per second squared. But if you want to know how fast she ended up going, that's where I was headed. Now that we have the impulse from the force and the time, we can also get it from delta P, right? So we can say 1,500 equals delta P is P final minus P initial. Right? Well, P initial was zero. She wasn't moving at the beginning. So then 1,500 is P final. Right? So P final is her mass times her final velocity. So you just divide that by her mass of 60, and you get 150 over 25 meters per second. Right, so V final. See, so the two things you know, the two ways to define it, let you sort of do problems. Problems where maybe you're given the force and the time and ask for how fast they go. You might be told the momentum changes this much, it happens this short, what was the force? Okay, but this is basically the equations you need, although this might be an integral. Well, we're going to talk more about that. I now have a joke here that's completely unrelated. I don't know how it was related to this, but I'll tell it anyway. What concert can you see for 45 cents? 50 Cent featuring Nickelback. No. I think I was letting my 14-year-old write all the jokes in here. I'm not sure. Okay, so now, let me check the time here. Yeah. So now what we're going to do is think about microscopic impulse. Let me erase real fast. And when two things hit, what's really happening? You maybe already got suspicious about Sense's story, that if you get hit in the back by an avalanche, is it just going to push you at a constant, whatever it was, 200 newtons or something? Probably not. It's probably going to be more complicated than that. Okay. So let's see. Okay, so what we want to do is look at microscopic impulse, is what I like to call it, because we're going to really think about the two objects hitting each other. Microscopic impulse. And what that is about is basically we're going to approximate the interaction. Because what we're going to find is if you look at the details, they're complicated. So how do we approximate it? That's really the big question. So what we're gonna do is hang a pendulum. But the pendulum in this case, this is like a baby Yoda hanging from a 3D printed baby Yoda hanging from the ceiling. So this is mass two in my diagram here. So this thing hanging down mass two. And mass one is going to be something that's going to hit mass two. And we're going to have a momentum transfer, a momentum change. We're going to have a force for a short amount of time. We have all kinds of impulses, things like that going on. Okay, so this object will be a Nerf gun bullet here. So, all right. So we're just going to hit Baby Yoda with a bullet and see what happens to Baby Yoda. Is it going to move towards the bullet, away from the bullet? Here we go. And there you saw. Bullet and Baby Yoda went away. All right. So let's think about physically what happened there. I just lost. Let me just change this real quick. And hopefully everything will be back. You can hear me. I can see that you can hear me. Okay, I'm back. Okay. All right, so let's think about what happened here. So I think I'll just draw this. Let me get it out of the way. All right, so and it's a different direction. All right, so this was object two, Baby Yoda, and the bullet was object one, came in like this. Baby Yoda's initial momentum was zero. The bullet's P1I was, well, it had a value. We're not gonna do numbers here, right? So it had some value. This one was zero, this one's coming here. And then what happened? The bullet, if we play it in slow motion, which I'll do on the recording, I guess, ends up going this way. P1 final, right? And then what happened to Baby Yoda? Now Baby Yoda's going that way. P2 final. So they hit each other. And what we can do is just think about Baby Yoda. The bullet came in and applied a force for a certain amount of time. But what really happened, if we were to really zoom in on Baby Yoda's back and on the front of the bullet, so Nerf bullets are soft and rubbery. So there was like an indentation. A bullet hit. The bullet is softer than the Baby Yoda printed plastic. So probably the bullet gave a little bit more than Baby Yoda did, because he's strong. Right? So, but somehow, when they first touch, there's a little force, and then the bullet tip gets all compressed, and it's rubbery and compressed, and the force is big. And then Baby Yoda moves away, and the bullet moves away, and the force goes back down. So if we wanted to draw this force realistically, it would not be a constant force. Okay, so here's F. Well, let's say this is the force on Baby Yoda. And when the bullet just starts to hit, it goes up like that and peaks, and then the bullet and Baby Yoda start to separate and it goes like that. So you have some complicated force. Okay, so if we wanted to deal with the impulse of that, we would have to say, okay, J, the impulse is the integral from when it started to when it stopped, T1, TF, from initial to final of that interaction, of that force function is a function of time times dt. We have to actually do that integral. It looks like a Gaussian to me. We'd have to take an integral of a Gaussian, which is like an error function or something, I forget. Okay, but you would just say, oh, well, it's the area under the curve. And that's how you solve it. Could do that. That's not what we're going to do. So in, not just in intro physics classes, but in the world in general, an approximation we make is, let's just pretend it was a constant force for the same amount of time. So let's pretend it looked like this. T, F, force on Baby Yoda. So if we were going all the way from T1 to T2, we'd pick the same T1 and the same T2 and say, where would I put this fake average force to get the same impulse? Okay, so this was the actual force on Baby Yoda changing. This is what we call the average force. Okay. Whether or not it's a mathematical average, like you're used to thinking of, where you add a bunch of numbers and divide by the number, don't worry about it. We call it the average force. Since it's over time, I believe it is that, but yeah. But now maybe you can see what's going on here is now we can say J is F average, and we don't have to do the integral because it's a rectangle, times delta T, or the delta T has to be the same T1 to T2. Okay. So here we got the area under the curve with an integral. Here we got the area under the curve because it's a rectangle. And we approximated the forces constant. But these two areas have to be the same. That's how we define this average force. Okay. So there's actually some math. This isn't just completely made up. We could have a problem and say, we shot Baby Yoda. What was the average force if the interaction was for some amount of time? And you could get there. Because in shooting Baby Yoda, you could measure, you would know how fast he ended up going. You could get his delta P, his change in momentum. You know, that change in momentum has to be this area. So if you were given a delta T, you could get the F average. That's kind of how you use this idea. So often you'll see F average and you'll be annoyed, but realize we're doing that to keep you from doing the interval. If you'd like to do the interval every time, then I guess you could. Just in case that wasn't dramatic enough, or you know, let's just take one more, let's do this one more time and make sure Baby Yoda goes away from the bullet, and maybe we'll be able to see the bullet deform on this really high speed webcam. Because we're going to do it now with I have a bigger gun here. This is the one I use to shoot students in the back of her CNAP in other years. Here we go. Okay, I need to hit him in a flat spot. Here we go. There you go. Maybe that will look good. Don't worry, Baby Yoda's fine. You would never harm the star of the show, you know. Let's see. Okay, so that is how these problems work. Okay, that's basically the idea of momentum, change of momentum, and impulse. So I'm going to skip this one. No, we're going to let me look at the time here. So let's run some numbers here, because this is one where it would be easy to mess it up. So let's, that's not erased. Yeah, let me just erase this. We're going to do the Baby Yoda problem mathematically real quick, and it'll make an important point. All right, let's look at the numbers here. So just for fun, I'm going to turn it back the other way. So here's Baby Yoda at rest. Here's the bullet. And we're going to say it weighs 100 grams. All right. And they hit each other. So Baby Yoda goes this way, V final of Yoda. And the bullet actually bounces backwards this way. It was going that way, bounces back that way. So some numbers we're going to throw into this problem is the dart was going, oh, here they are. It was going 5 meters per second. It rebounds at 4 meters per second. And then there's a lot of things you could ask, like what's the J? What is the change of momentum? What's the impulse? Impulse of the bullet. Oh, okay, you say, well, it's delta P. It's the P final minus initial. All right. Oh, you could say, well, I'll just take the difference in the velocities and multiply by the mass. And you'll say 5 minus 4 is 1 times 0.1. You'll get 0.1 kilogram meters per second. And that is wrong. Okay. There's a vector. This is the part I was saying. The vector part will matter. Okay. I just subtracted the magnitude is 5 minus 4. But look, it's going this way at 5, and it goes this way at 4. It bounces back. Ah, so if we're going to write magnitudes in here kind of carefully, we'd say, I mean, we can go ahead and be cavalier and put 0.1 on the outside and say it's the difference in velocities, you know, you guys are so advanced, you can do that. So V final minus V initial. Well, if we're gonna write it without vector notation, which I know you like to do, we have to put the signs in. So final, let's say back is the positive direction, just to be convenient. I think that's why I had to go the other way. So that'd be 4. And I'm gonna make it positive, because that's positive direction, minus, but then what is this? Minus 5, okay? The minus sign in a difference formula does not account for which way the two are going, okay? There's a minus sign just because it's a difference. So that minus is part of the formula. This minus is here because the 5 is the other way. So 4 minus minus 5, of course, is 4 plus 5, which is 9. So the answer is 0.9. So this is a very common mistake to make. When something bounces back, or when two of your momentums or velocities are in the opposite direction, and you want the difference, you actually add the magnitudes in 1D. And then you could say, if the interaction was 80 seconds, what was the average force?
Let's write this and look at it later.
I'm sorry, millisecond. 80 millisecond interaction. What is FF? Like we talked about before. Say, well, the impulse we just calculated, 0.9 kilogram meters per second equals the average force that you're looking for, maybe G, times the delta T, which is the 0.80 milliseconds, 0.08 seconds. So you just 0.9 divided by 0.08, which is a little bigger than 10, 11.25 seconds. All right. So the formulas we're using are all just trivial algebra. They're just F equals, J equals F delta T, you know, P equals MV. The tricky part of these is just keeping up with vectors, directions, and all that. And then we'll tell you more fun aspects about it in the second half. Cool. All right. I believe it is a break time.
Yes, it is. 10:22.
All right. I'll see you in 5 minutes.
Okay, so we're going to look carefully at impulse. And there's another book. So Newton's book is about momentum. I actually found another book about impulse. Here it is. It's called Impulse. And it's by Stephen Gould. Scent has a secret. Okay? She lives in isolation with her parents. Okay, that's not really possible. Let's keep going. Isolation with her parents, hiding from the people who took her father captive and tortured him to gain control over his ability to teleport. Okay, it's sci-fi. Okay. And from the government agencies that want to use his talent. Scent has seen the world, but only from the safety of her parents' arms. She's teleported more than anyone on Earth, except her mother and father. But she's never been able to do it herself. Her life has never been in danger until the day she went snowboarding without permission and triggered an avalanche. When the snow and ice thundered down on her, she suddenly found herself in her own bedroom. Boom, she teleported. Oh my God, I have got to read that book. That was the first time. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to go through what happened to Scent up until the moment that she teleported, okay? And we're going to do that as the problem. If you're ever giving a presentation and you need to fill in a little something or other, take the subject of your presentation, put it in Amazon Books, and you'll have a good 30 seconds, okay? You can also do movies. I did movies, but they were a little too spicy for 125, if you know what I'm saying. Movies called Impulse are kind of a problem.
All right, here we go. That was a lot about momentum and impulse. Now we want to see how that can lead us to the idea that momentum is conserved. Okay, so here's the statement that's gonna stick in your head. It's gonna help you remember. Impulse is a two-way street. What do we mean by a two-way street? So we're gonna think again about the forces between the bullet and Baby Yoda. Okay, and we're gonna remember, let's see, so here was the bullet, it was coming here, Baby Yoda is here, and when they touch, let's draw it real quick again, and let's remind ourselves that the forces between the bullet and Baby Yoda are an action-reaction pair. Because why would they not be? It's two objects pushing on each other. This one pushes that one. This one pushes back. There's got to be a push on the bullet as well, because it bounced back. I mean, it has to. It's not going to bounce back for no reason. So we clearly can see there's a force on Baby Yoda, but there's also a force pushing back. I could draw it here at the interface. That's a little confusing. Let's just do two free body diagrams. Let's say here is the force the bullet applies to Yoda. I'll do Y. BY. B on Y. And that's what Baby Yoda feels. And the bullet feels a force that Baby Yoda applies to the bullet. So he does have to apply force to the bullet. We don't have to really even try. Right? It's just going to happen because of the Newton's third law, and then they're going to back off. Okay. So, F B. No, I'm going to skip a few of these bullets because I said them right. So the force B Y pushes Baby Yoda forward. The force of the Yoda on the bullet pushes the bullet backwards. And the key. What is the key for Newton's? Let's see. Bullet on Yoda is that the magnitudes are the same. Right? Equal and opposite. Opposite here in terms of direction, equal in terms of magnitude. So that's one thing. So equal mag and opposite direction. But there's one more critical thing they have in common that is going to set us up for the conservation momentum. And that is the same duration. Same duration, delta T. Now, why fundamentally is it the same duration? It has to be. I mean, when they're touching, they're pushing on each other. They have to be touching for the same amount of time. Because if they're touching, they're both touching. Like this one can't be touching that one, but this one's not touching that one, right? They're always touching. So during this interaction, which is not a constant force, right? It's actually a changing force. We can approximate it as a constant force. If we were to draw those two curves, if we were to draw the force versus time, it'd be the same curve, except they're in opposite directions. So that is going to be the key here. So let me put this up. Draw a little bit more for you. He's back with a vengeance. All right. Okay, so let's plot them. Those two forces, and you'll see here, we're gonna plot, this is the force of the bullet on Baby Yoda, and this is the force of Yoda on the bullet. All right, so this one we'll call positive. This is the force on Baby Yoda to the right. Right is usually positive. And we know it really looks something like this. Right? Even if we approximate it later as force average, it looks something like that. What about the force Y on Baby Yoda? Same magnitude at every point in time, opposite direction. Versus T. time, so I need it to look exactly the same like that. Okay. So this is positive J, positive impulse on Baby Yoda, negative impulse on the boy, because impulse is a vector, right? So the direction matters for impulse. So what does this mean? So since J equals delta P, what we could then say is that, well, you could say that J, the impulse of the Yoda is a vector, plus J of the bullet is a vector, equals, that's part of it to make first, so this above that. So these two vectors, their sum is zero. Same magnitude, opposite directions. Okay. And since it's equal to delta P, you can also say that delta P on Baby Yoda plus delta P on the bullet equals zero. And this is basically what's telling you that momentum is conserved. And now we'll put the bad part for an isolated system. Okay, so a few comments about this before we move on is, one is this is really telling you, I think I told you earlier that all of Newton's laws are about momentum. And it's really Newton's third law that's really about conservation of momentum. If every action has to have an equal and opposite reaction, and if you by that you mean forces, what we just went through, the forces have to be equal and opposite, but they also have to be for the same time. If they're the same force, magnitude, equal and opposite, same time, you calculate impulse sum has to be zero for two things interacting. If that's all that's happening, is the two things interacting. If that's zero, change of momentum has to be zero, which basically means the total momentum is constant. Right? You can see that. If this is a positive, this has to be negative. If in this interaction, this picked up some momentum, this had to lose momentum. Of course, it's going the opposite direction, so that's going to naturally happen. All right? So here is a specific case of a bullet, a Baby Yoda, in my house in front of a board. But this is generally true. Right? There's nothing specific to this about shooting dolls, right? This is true throughout the universe. Okay. So that's what's really happening. So now what we want to do is take a little bit and talk about this isolated system idea. That's usually what bothers people about this. It's not the conservation of momentum. It's how do I find the isolated system? Okay, I'm gonna take an eraser break here. So I'll get too far behind. Isolated system. Oh, yeah. My definition was third law reacts only, but that's old. So let's go with the actual definition. Is a collection of objects and their actions. I don't do a good job of making this short and clear. This is sort of a bookish definition of objects and their actions. Collection of object interactions, oh my God, where every force has a reaction force within the collection. That kind of has to be true, right? The collection. I guess that's why I wrote third law reacts only was the reason. And now here what I was going to add, this is kind of a bookish definition. Here's the part that makes it tricky. In problems for the dimension you care about,
you can sort of skirt the rules by only considering one dimension.
And this is what usually causes a lot of confusion in trying to find, you know, an isolated system. So here, like an easy case, it's just two isolated masses in the universe. Here's mass one, moving along V. Here's mass two. Clearly they're gonna hit each other. And when they hit each other, they'll push on each other. You could call it a normal force or a contact force. Basically, they can't occupy the same space at the same time, so they push on each other. So while they're touching, this one feels a force that way, this one feels a force that way. Equal and opposite force. This is a pretty easy to find isolated system. It's the only things in the universe. So that's as isolated as you can get. Let's look at another case where we're going to find an isolated system. Another case. Two masses on a frictionless table. That doesn't sound so bad, right? It's like, well, they're probably isolated if they're on a frictionless table. But this is that thing I was saying about you got to only consider one certain dimensions. Whether this is an isolated system or not. Hard to say. I always like to draw a little dotted line around it and say, there's my isolated system. Or we're already in trouble because I drew a little bit of the table in it. And that's the hint, is that, is this isolated or not? So we could do, one way that might help you is to draw the free body diagrams of the two, right? When they hit. So here they are hitting. And draw their free body diagrams. We'll put one here and two here. Okay, so while they're hitting, you say, well, this one feels a force back, force of two on one. This one felt a force forward, one on two. Equal and opposite forces apply for the same direction. Opposite impulses, minimus conserved. But that's not the full free body diagram. What if we consider other dimensions? M1G, normal on one, M2G. Normal on two. And you say, okay, well, that's also third law pair. But no, it isn't. So we talked this before when we talked about Newton's laws. The third law pair for the weight is the force of this one's gravitational attraction to this one and the Earth. Right? It's the same thing here. We have to include the Earth in the system. And then therefore, what is the reaction with the reaction pair with the normal forces? It's the force on the table. Right? There's the table being pushed down by reactive normal forces, one and two. So the system actually has to be both blocks, the table and the Earth. So that kind of takes away the mathematical convenience of an isolated system, doesn't it? Yes. So that's what you got to do is get used to the idea that I can think of this as isolated in the one dimension that I care about. It's technically not isolated. So I'm just telling you this to be aware of it. If you start to think about it too much and get confused like this, then realize, oh yeah, I do have to include the Earth. Anytime there's a weight, I have to include the Earth. Or books. So whatever book you're reading, hopefully you're reading some book, they will often say, don't forget the Earth's in the system, or now the Earth isn't in the system. That's because they mean they're just in one dimension. So it can be very confusing. I just wanted to point out it's hard to find third law pairs sometimes. Okay. In physics, we have a thing where if there's like a couple that like is always fighting and doesn't get along, we call them a third law pair. Like those two, total third law pair. But there's so few couples that essentially never comes up. I've got now, let me see how much time we have. Seventeen minutes, okay. Okay, one subtlety and one complicated problem in conservation of momentum. All right. So this subtlety comes up when, because of that whole vector thing. Remember I told you that there'll be
tricky times when you gotta remember the momentum is a vector, or you'll screw the problem up. So before it was when something changes direction. Here's another case. So I used to do this as a demo. With a student, I'd bring on a brave student, and we would stand on these carts that we have, very low friction carts, very dangerous. And we would stand and we would touch hands. So it was awkward even back then. Now it's not even allowed. So, and what would we do? We would push off of each other. So our hand would have to actually touch. We'd push. And after we push, I would move back. Me going back. And this student would move this way, like that. V1, V2, say. And with problems like this, the question is, did we conserve momentum? Well, what's the system? Oh, the earth and the cart and the floor, Okay, one dimension. What's the system? It's just the two of us. Okay, so what's our initial momentum? Equals zero. And we seem to have broken the conservation of momentum. Because I have momentum. You have momentum. We all have momentum. But what is the total momentum? P final equals zero. Because if we work the problem out, the whole way you would solve a problem like this, it would ask how fast did they go, is you would know that since it started as zero, these have to be equal and opposite. So our velocities that we end up with are the same as the ratio of our masses. And the heavier person goes slower, the lighter person goes faster. I usually pick someone with a different mass than me, or I hope they have a different mass. Actually, I think I put really heavy weights on mine, so we don't have to get into people's mass. Anyway, the point is, you can create momentum. You can appear to create momentum. Two things can push off of each other and just start moving. They've created momentum, but the total momentum is zero. So you gotta keep up with that. Don't think that you can really create momentum. You can locally create momentum, but in the entire system, there's no increase in momentum. Now you could say, what if I made the system just me, and I do this exercise? Then I created momentum, but the system isn't isolated. See, if this person pushed you, you're not isolated anymore. You have what we call an external force, right? When you have an external force, then momentum is not constant. Here's something fun. Sum of the forces equals MA, but what is A? dv dt, but now we put the m in here, and what do we get? What is dmv dt? What is mv? dp dt. See, Newton's second law really is about the change of momentum. If you have external forces, the momentum of the system can change. If you have zero external forces, the momentum of the system can't change and it's conserved. See, even Newton's second law is about momentum. They're all about momentum. Okay, so this has been such a violent lecture. I feel like I want to end it with more violence and go through my shotgun problem. We have a lot of time, it takes a little while. I'm just changing something. Let's see. I'm on this side, it's easier to see. So everything we've done so far has been sort of ideal things with no friction and simple algebraic formulas. So this problem is getting a little more realistic. Okay. All right. I came up with this problem when thinking about trying to be involved in the dad's club at my kid's school. I try so hard, but I just, you know, I mean, I like people and stuff. And I'm like, okay, this high school, I'm gonna join the dad's club. I'm gonna be active. And then the very first event was going to the Houston Shotgun Club to shoot clay pigeons. And I grew up in the country. I've shot clay pigeons before, all right? I've never shot a gun before. I mean, it's not like I've never shot a gun. I've shot plenty of guns. But I don't really want to shoot live shotguns with a bunch of people I don't know. Like, how stable are these people, really? they have teenagers. So I'm not really interested in, anyway, I'm bad. I didn't join the dad's club. The second thing was golf anyway, but I did write this problem about it. So, you know, the dad's club contributed to this problem. And the question is simple. If I had a shotgun and I was sitting on one of these low friction kind of things, would it move me backwards? You know, we all know like a gun will kick, but the question is, if I was sitting on a platform, would I slide backwards when I shoot the gun? Like that. Okay. Not really. This one isn't quite heavy enough. We're going to look at some realistic numbers and see, like, you know, think about the kick of a shotgun. So here we are. So let's say we're on a low friction kind of a platform, and we shoot a gun, right? So the bullet, these are typical numbers, comes out at 500 meters per second out of the gun. Its mass is 30 grams, right? The length of the barrel, it's not a muzzle, I guess. It's not the 18th century. It is about a meter. And I am about 70 kilograms. I lost 10 kilograms since the last problem. So there you go. I need to hydrate. Okay. So we look at this and we say, okay, we got to conserve momentum. So we are an isolated system. Isolated in one dimension. Okay, so delta P equals zero. And another thing about these delta P formulas is, I forgot, these sort of freak people out a little bit. So delta P equals zero. That means that the delta P of the individual objects must be zero. So let's write it this way. Delta P of, let's say M for me, plus delta P of the bullet has to be zero. But if you don't like working in deltas, what you can just do is say, okay, the momentum of me final minus the momentum of me initial plus the momentum of the bullet final minus the momentum of the bullet initial. All that has to be zero. Okay. Remember, deltas are always final minus initial, final minus initial. So you could rewrite this in a way that maybe makes more sense for conservation, that the initials equal the finals. And so we put the initials on the right side, they become positive. Finals on the left side, flip them around, and we got that my initial momentum plus the bullet's initial momentum equals my final momentum plus the bullet's final momentum. So maybe that's how you like to think of conservation. Initial momentum equals final momentum. Right? You can do it either way. So let's look at this and see if I would move backwards. Well, the way we set up, I have to move backwards. We'll get it more detailed in a minute. So let's see, we could do it with any of these formulas, really. Let's use this one just to do something different. So initials, I wasn't moving. Neither was the bullet. So zero on that side. Now my final momentum is back, right? So 70, and then V final, plus the bullet is 30 grams, 0.03 times its 500. So this is all magnitudes, so just call that, just take the vector symbol off that. And if you solve that, you see you're going to get, what, it's 500 plus 0.03 divided by 70, 0.21 meters per second, and it's going to be negative. Mathematically, this would come out negative if it was a vector component. V final is minus 0.21 meters per second. You also know it's negative because you know what's going to happen here. Bullet goes that way, I have to go this way. Right, So with that problem, you know, it's just with two bodies, it's only so complicated we can get these things. Okay. That says I would move back at 0.21 meters per second. But if I'm standing, I'm not going to get shoved back at 0.21 meters per second. If I'm on a frictionless gliding thing, I would. But what I think is interesting is let's put a little bit of friction in here and see realistically would I get pushback if we had some realistic friction. So to do that, we've got to go back to forces and kind of go back to the way we were doing things before. Let's see if we have time. Okay, there's a conference going outside my window here. Okay, so let's think then, what is the force? We got to get the actual forces here. We don't really have that much information, but we do know that the bullet accelerated. So let's look at that. What is the acceleration of the bullet? So it's not as straightforward as it looks, right? We know it went from 0 to 500 meters per second, but we don't know how long in time. We know how far it went. It took it a meter to go from 0 to 500 meters per second. It doesn't speed up once it's outside. Like the way a gun works is pressure in the barrel is what speeds it up. So that pressure pushed it, and as soon as it left the barrel, it's done. So we accelerated for a time. So from there, we want to use that the combo kinematics equation. Right, so V final squared is, V initial squared is 0. Plus, oh, I'm sorry, V final was 500. 500 squared equals initial is 0 plus 2, the acceleration we're looking for, 1 meter. All right, something like that. See, it's 250,000 divided by 2. All right, so the acceleration is 125,000 meters per second squared. Pretty fast. No, it's a bullet. It has to accelerate over a pretty short distance. So then you can say, well, how long is it in here? Because we want to think of, ultimately about an impulse. Okay. So then you do 1/2 AT squared. It went 1 meter. Delta X equals 1/2 AT squared. So about 1 meter and 1/2, 125,000 T squared. So you can figure out that it flew through there in 4 milliseconds. So half there, take the square root, flip it over. All right. So now we're getting somewhere, because now let's think about what we know. We know that this thing got from 0 to 500. We know it's change in momentum, and we know it's change in time, or we know how long it took. So what we can do is use impulse now. So let's keep going here. All right, let me just erase this side. Yeah, we'll just move over. So we're not going to be able to flip back and look at it anyway. Okay. So we can say, let's look at the bullet impulse. So let's see, F times delta T equals the delta P. And we're assuming an average force, constant average force. We're not going to do some integral, have to do some like thermodynamics, gas kinetics and stuff. We're going to do that. So F average times, it was 4 milliseconds. That's the impulse on the bullet. The change of momentum is momentum final minus momentum initial, 500 meters per second times 0.03 final minus initial is 0. There you go. So now because we know the time that we got from the kinematics, we can get the force, and it's big, 3750 newtons. Are applied on the bullet, right? Which means 3750 newtons are applied to me, are applied to the person holding the gun. Sounds like a lot of force. Fortunately, it's only for 4 milliseconds, so it does hurt, but yeah, it's not going to kill you. If it was for a second, that would be a real problem. So would this overcome friction? Well, here I am on this block. I was on a skateboard. See, I was on a skateboard. Right. Is it with a lot of wheels for some reason? Right. It just comes to a question of what's the friction coefficient? So let's say it's really low. Say it's, say it's 0.1. Right. So reasonably oiled wheels. So the force of friction, it's not equal to, it's less than or equal to, you can only get up to mu s times the normal force, so 0.1. The normal force, in this case, is my weight, because because there's no motion in the y direction. So 70, I think I claim, times 9.8. Sorry, it's getting messy, but you can see, you get the idea. It's my typical 700 newtons times 0.1. It's about 68.6 newtons. So it takes 68.6 newtons to push me back. So clearly, 3750 is enough. If you want to go even further, you could estimate how friction is going to slow you down. All right, the bullet gets the full 3750 if you ignore air drag. I don't quite get the full 3750, so we have to throw in a little bit of friction. So if we wanted to have a problem where we brought back stuff from the first half plus this, this would be kind of the way to do it. So I would move if I shot the shotgun on a skateboard. And I planned shooting somebody accidentally, so that would be bad. Then I'd be kicked out of the dad's club. All right, that's it. So Thursday, we'll do collisions. I've posted the homework, and in previous years, we've spent more time on this. It's kind of a week and a half of homework. It's 21 questions. So I might try to find a few to remove if that's too much. But you always like practice, so I'll look at how hard they are. I think there might be a lot of quickies in there. Okay, see you Thursday.